I am Akhil Kumar, and today I am with noted economist John Rees. We are here to speak to him about a recent government notification that makes Aadhaar card mandatory for midday meals. Midday meals is a central government scheme where children are provided free meals if they attend government school. So we are just going to head direct to the discussion with John. Welcome to this interview, John. Let's begin this discussion with talking about the importance of midday meal and the role they are playing in bringing more children to school. So, because you have worked in rural areas as well, and you are also a developmental economist, so can you please start off by explaining more about the midday meal?
Sure. Well, I think India's school meal program is widely considered, for good reasons, as one of India's best social programs. Firstly, as you said, it has helped to increase school participation, it has reduced the gender gap in school participation, it has helped in particular children from deprived communities to go to school, but it has also done a lot more than that. It has helped child nutrition. There's some evidence that it also helps with pupil achievements. It's creating a lot of employment for poor women in rural India who work as cooks and helpers in the schools. It also helps children to learn to share a meal irrespective of the barriers of class and caste. So it's doing a lot of good in different ways, and all the more so recently because eggs have been introduced in the midday meal program in many states, so the nutrition value has shot up. So I think we have every reason to continue to improve and consolidate this program instead of disrupting it, as is being done now with this pointless notification, which serves no other purpose than to promote Aadhaar.
Even the Supreme Court of India, in a series of judgments, has specified that Aadhaar cannot be made compulsory for welfare-based schemes. So the big question here is this decision even legal? Is this notification even legal?
I think it's illegal. It's important to understand these orders. Basically, the Supreme Court did not do anything more than to clarify what is meant by Aadhaar being voluntary, which is what the government has been claiming all along and is still claiming today. The government says Aadhaar is voluntary, so the Supreme Court said, okay, if it's voluntary, then it cannot be made compulsory for any service to which citizens are otherwise entitled. I think that's a very important and useful clarification of what it means for Aadhaar to be compulsory, because before that, there was a kind of fiction, there was a rhetoric of voluntariness, but actually Aadhaar was and is still being imposed on a growing number of things. So if you can't have a SIM card without Aadhaar, you can't open a bank account without Aadhaar, you can't book a train ticket without Aadhaar, you can't have your midday meal without Aadhaar, then obviously it would not be voluntary in any meaningful sense of the term. So the Supreme Court orders basically say, fine, if it's voluntary, then it cannot be made compulsory for any service to which people are otherwise entitled. Furthermore, the Supreme Court has reiterated this in a whole series of orders even after the Aadhaar Act was passed. So the claim that the Aadhaar Act overrides these orders is not correct. In fact, the last occasion, I think, is 14 September 2016, when the Supreme Court said, these are the exact words, that Aadhaar must be purely voluntary until the matter is finally decided by this court in one way or another. So I don't think there's any doubt that these orders continue to apply, and therefore that this notification is illegal.
Okay, so coming back to the question of the efficiency of Aadhaar itself, because the main argument that the government and other those who favor Aadhaar, those who are trying to push Aadhaar in different sectors, say that it will be very helpful in welfare-based schemes, because presently there are a lot of leakages from the center till the time, you know, the welfare reaches from the center to the to the ground. So
the rhetoric is that Aadhaar is supposed to help welfare schemes, but the reality all along has been exactly the other way around, that the welfare schemes are being used to help Aadhaar, in particular to create a dependence on Aadhaar and to constrain people to get enrolled. And in this particular case, the effort is specifically to put pressure on parents to send their children to Aadhaar and enrollment centers. So it's yet another case where a welfare scheme is being used to help Aadhaar rather than the other way around. Now, of course, nobody would deny that there may be some siphoning of food in the midday meal program, but this is not going to help. In fact, if you look at the fine print of the notification, There's nothing in it that says that, you know, we are going to make lists of these other numbers and deduplicate them or do any such thing. All it says is that to get the midday meal, the child has to show proof that it has an ADA number and otherwise get an ADA number. Now, so if the purpose is to reduce corruption, this is not going to help in any way. If the purpose is to coerce people to send their children to the ADA enrollment centers, then of course this does serve the purpose very well. So the wording of the notification confirms the hypothesis, which is in any case very plausible, that the real purpose of this notification is not particularly to help the midday meal program, but to promote ADAR and specifically to force parents to send their children to ADAR enrollment centers.
Why do you think the government is pushing ADAR so aggressively? What could be the possible reason?
I think there is a kind of convergence of corporate and state interests. There are lots of corporate interests, you know, from the biometric industry, from the software industry, from the security industry. And then, of course, for the state, it's a great way of keeping track of the entire population all the time. I think it's going to create an extraordinary infrastructure of surveillance, which will enable the state to know at all times, you know, where we are going, who we are talking to, and so on and so forth. I don't think it has much to do with improving welfare schemes. And in fact, the evidence, at least so far, is that ADAR creates more disruption than facilitation in the context of welfare schemes. It has certainly disrupted the public distribution system very badly in states where ADAR-based biometric authentication has been imposed, and there's a risk now that it will disrupt midday meals as well. So I think if we take a realistic view, this is the story.
Okay, so you say that this is not a good decision. So can you elaborate more? Like you said, that it has been disruptive in other public distribution system at work. So can you elaborate more on what exactly, how exactly is it going to be disruptive?
I can give you a couple of examples of the past disruption. I mean, in Jharkhand, Rajasthan and Andhra Pradesh, biometric authentication has been imposed on the public distribution system. So it means that to get your monthly ration of rice or wheat or whatever, you have to authenticate yourself through ADAR. That system is by nature internet-based. So in order for this authentication to work, the internet has to work, the servers have to work, the biometrics have to work, your data has to have been properly seeded in the database and so on. So there's so many hurdles. And the consequence everywhere is that even after months of the technology being put in place, a very substantial number of people are still not able to use the system. And even those who are using it, face a lot of hassle. They have to go repeatedly to the ration shop, or they have to send different household members until one of them is able to pass the authentication test. So it creates a lot of disruption and of exclusion, which is really not acceptable in the context of a rights-based program. Same story with pensions. Many pensioners in several states have been excluded from pensions because they didn't have an ADAR number. In the case of midday meal, the disruption may or may not be very large. I think the main problem is that it will waste the time of many teachers and principals who will be spending time running behind the children and getting them enrolled when they have better things to do. But it could create a lot of disruption later if the next step is to impose biometric authentication of children every day for midday meals, which would be a very bad idea. I hope that there's no such plan, but if that happens, it's likely to create a lot of disruption.
Okay, since ADAR, the whole idea of linking UID for better efficiency is also in its nascent stage in India.
You say it's in a nascent stage, but actually it's moving very fast. And I think this is one concern, that we're moving now very rapidly to a kind of irreversible situation where the bulk of the population will be trapped in this virtually irreversible system, which creates an unprecedented infrastructure of state surveillance. In particular, in the case of midday meals, you are basically asking children to enroll for the sake of the midday meal. And it's a kind of lifetime. Basically, they're exposing themselves to lifetime surveillance by the state in a kind of irreversible manner. So I think it's moving fast, and we are not in a nascent stage anymore.
The main argument here seems to be that it is being done to prevent leakages and corruption. So if not ADAR, what do you think could be a possible more effective solution? to avoid leakages. And
I think we have to be careful not to get into this trap, because I don't think that is the purpose of this notification. I think the notification is there to promote ADA. Now, having said this, of course, there is a need for transparency safeguards in all the social programs, including midday meals. Actually, I think in the case of midday meals, we have to basically make sure that the attendance records are accurate. I mean, that's where there's a vulnerability, that if the teachers are very corrupt and unscrupulous, it's possible that they inflate the attendance records and then siphon off the food. I am not aware of much evidence of this. I have not heard of any. And that's another reason why this notification is objectionable, because if at all it addresses a real problem, there is no evidence of that problem being there. But anyway, the safeguards should take the form of trying to make the attendance records more transparent, open to scrutiny, more verification, and of course action against anyone who is caught falsifying these records. It's not really so difficult.
Also, for those who oppose this move, those who are saying that this is just to get, to strengthen the surveillance system of the state, and say that this will not really be very helpful in preventing leakages or any such thing in welfare-based schemes. What is the way forward now? Can this notification be challenged in the court, or what can be done now?
Well, I hope that it will be challenged in the court, because to me it looks clearly illegal. And actually, it's a little surprising that the Supreme Court is not more concerned about the fact that its orders are being violated over and over again. So I hope that the Supreme Court will take interest in this matter and that the notification will be challenged.
Okay, that would be all. Thank you for joining us, Suresh.